Having introduced the singular simplicial chain complex, or a simplicial complex, as a subcomplex of the singular chain complex of mod K, we shall now go for another simplification, a further simplification. This time, we are not going to treat it as a subcomplex, but as a quotient complex, which is the natural way of doing it. So let this sigma, capital sigma n plus 1, denote the permutation group on n plus 1 letters. To each alpha inside sigma n plus 1, that means a permutation of n plus 1 letters, we will get a simplicial homeomorphism from delta n to delta n, because any map, any set theoretic map from vertex set to vertex set is a simplicial map in delta n. In particular, if you have a permutation of vertices that can be extended linearly to mod delta n to mod delta n, which will be automatically a homeomorphism. Okay, so that we denote by G alpha. Okay, so this element represents an action of sigma n plus 1 on Sn of delta n by merely composing on the right. Namely, take a lambda, which is a simplicial map. Okay, take lambda composite G alpha. That means you take first G alpha and then compose it with lambda. Okay. So that gives you right action of sigma n plus 1 on sigma, on set of all Sn of delta n. Okay. Because Gns are all simplicial, the composite will be also a simplicial map. That's all that we have to do. Once you have it on simplicial, simplex, then you can extend it linearly for all the elements of Sn by summation nj lambda j of alpha going to nj lambda j of alpha summed up. Okay. This notation is standard notation in the many literatures about the action, writing it on the top. Usually it comes from group theory, wherein conjugation by an element was simplified by this writing like this. And most often it is the conjugation of the group on itself which is studied, that action is studied very thoroughly. So that must be the motivation for writing like this. So I am following that notation, that's all here. Okay. A simplicial map delta n to any simplicial complex K is called degenerate n simplex if the dimension of lambda of delta n is strictly less than n, which is the same thing as saying that the vertex function lambda from vertices of delta n to vertices of k is not injective. If it's an injective and it's a simplicial map, then mod delta n would have been embedded as a n simplex, so the dimension would have been the same. Okay, so such things are called degenerate, and anything which is not degenerate will be non-degenerate. That means when lambda is injective. Okay, so let us look at all those elements in Sn of K which are, you know, generated by subgroups of certain things, namely degenerate simplexes, all degenerate simplexes, and also of the form lambda minus the signature of alpha times lambda alpha. So all these elements as well as degenerate elements we are taking together, they may not form a subgroup, but take the subgroup generated by them. This is abelian group. So inside that, you generate a abelian subgroup of that. Okay, the idea is that throw away all these things, go model all these things, kill them. Because the simplest thing that we want to say is, if you, comma you, you know, as a geometric object, it will be a single element, though it is representing a edge, just like a constant loop, or just like anything which is contractible loop, etc. We have taken them away in the homotopy theory. So this is a very obvious thing that we have to do. Namely, all the degenerate simplexes, they don't count. Similarly, if you have a lambda and then you interchange the two vertices, that should be minus lambda. So that is the kind of relation that we want to introduce here. Signature of alpha, if alpha is a alpha is a transposition, signature of alpha is minus one. Okay, so lambda plus the interchanger thing, that should be killed, which is the same thing as lambda will be equal to minus of lambda alpha, where alpha is a transposition. More generally, when alpha is any permutation, I have to put the signature there. Okay. So this is what we want to identify. So I am taking this as a subgroup, you know, a subgroup to generate these subgroups and then throw them away. Okay, one by one I could have done, but I can do them together and simultaneously. Namely, all degenerate simplexes and all lambda minus this one, they will generate a subgroup. That subgroup is S naught of K. Okay. Obviously, it is a chain subgroup. In other words, boundary of this S naught of N will be contained inside S naught of N minus 1, and so on. And if we verify that, then this will be a subchain complex. Whenever you have a subchain complex, you can take the quotient and that will give you another chain complex. So this is what we have to verify here. Boundary of S naught N is contained in the S naught N minus. Okay. So here, for the generators, if I show it, then it is then the whole thing will follow, because lambda daba is also a linear map. Okay. So daba is also a linear map. Daba of A plus B is daba A plus daba B. Daba of N times A is N times daba A. So it is enough to verify this for generator. First, we shall first check that the boundary of a degenerate simplex is inside here. Boundary of a degenerate simplex may not be a degenerate simplex. It may be a chain. Okay, or it may have this kind of elements also. You see, that is the whole idea of putting them together. Okay, so let us start with a lambda from delta n to k, okay, such that dimension of lambda n is less than n. Let us call it as m. If this m is actually less than n minus 1, that means there are at most n minus 2 elements out of n plus 1 element. That means either 3 elements have gone to the same element, or there must be pairs of 2 pairs of elements, say u1, u2 and u3, u4, like that, which have gone to the same element. Right? This is purely set theoretic argument. Number of elements from n plus 1, if you have gone to n minus 1, then that is what must have happened. Okay. If 3 elements have gone to the same element, when you take the boundary, what happens? You are deleting only one at a time, and then putting a minus sign and then doing that, right? In the boundary formula. In each of them, still there will be two different elements going to the same element. Therefore, it's a sum of degenerate simplicity, the boundary of that one. Okay, so that is the whole idea here. So once, since boundary of lambda is sum of simplicial maps, each obtained by deleting only one vertex at a time, it follows that boundary of lambda is a sum of degenerate and minor n simplexes. So this is happens when both the cases. If you have three of them going to same element, you delete one of them. Mainly we do, you are deleting one at a time. Which one you don't know. If it happens to be one of the three, still the other two will be going to same element. So it's a degenerate. If two pairs of things are going to same elements, then when you're deleting one of them from the one of the pair, the other pair is still there. Other pair, two of them are going to same element. Therefore, in either case, this will be sum of degenerate simplicities, the boundary. So that is done. The second case is what? M equal to n minus 1 itself. Okay, that means only a pair of elements have been identified and all other things are injectively going, distinct elements. Okay, so let us say ith and jth vertices of the same are mapped to the same vertex for some 0 less than I less than j less than equal to n, we can assume. So in this case, boundary of DABA consists of a sum of a number of degenerate n minus 1 simplices, wherein when you are dropping some element, it is neither ith element nor jth element. Okay, so all that in I and jth, both of them are going to the, they are present and they are going to the same element, so it is a degenerate. Okay, so there will be two terms, namely when you drop ith element, whatever you get is a non-degenerate simplex. Similarly, when you delete jth element, that will be also non-degenerate. So we need to check what happens in this case. So this is the interesting case. So what happens is, all other terms have been degenerate, you can forget about it. What are the two terms remaining here? This is in the expression of boundary of lambda. Okay, minus 1 to the I, vi hat, minus 1 to the j, vj hat. All other things are there. Is that clear? But vi hat and vj hat, the images are the same, right? So this vj and vi hat is, sorry, vi, it is, vi and vj are images the same. So this v naught vj minus 1 is there. This vi is, no, whatever, let us say vi is some u. It is in the j minus 1 place. Whereas here it is in the ith place. So you have to bring that one element into the ith element and then see what happens by transposing, by changing the order. When you change that order, what you get is this element is equal to minus of that element with the appropriate sign. Okay. So when you do that, performing I plus j minus 1 transpositions, you can bring it to this place. Okay. Then the form, if you write the first one as tau, the second one will be minus signature of alpha times tau alpha, where alpha is the transposition, is the permutation required to make the second one look like the first one. So boundary of lambda is always in S naught of k minus 1. The next case is, you start with a lambda minus signature of alpha times lambda alpha. What is the boundary of this? This should also belong to SK minus 1, no? That also you have to show. Okay. By writing it as a sum of a number of writing alpha as a product of transpositions, okay, and then adding and deleting several times. What you can do is you can bring this to verifying lambda plus alpha, lambda raised to alpha, where alpha is a permutation, alpha is a transposition. When alpha is a transposition, signature of alpha is minus. So this becomes lambda plus lambda to the power of. Okay. So boundary of this, how does it look like? If you show that these things are here, then an element of this form is sum of such elements, finitely sum of, so that will be also there. So the case is reduced to the case when alpha is just a transposition. Okay. So we will leave this to you as an exercise. You have to just write the boundary of alpha in each of them case. Lambda could be just like here, you have to do that. This we will leave it to you as an exercise. Okay? Unless you toil that much, you won't know what these symbols are, what is the meaning of boundary and so on. Okay? So this part we will leave it as an exercise. Now we can define whatever we have promised, namely, a further simplification of the chain complex. So what we do, we take this subgroup S naught, go modulo that from SNK. Remember, SNK was all singular simplicial maps. Okay, simplicial chains. So go modulo those which are degenerate or which correspond to under permutation. Okay, lambda minus signature of alpha times lambda power alpha. Okay, go modulo that. This will become now, C dot will become a chain group. Okay, a chain complex. Sn of k to Sn minus 1 of k, the same DABA induces a homomorphism of degree minus 1, such that DABA square is 0. On CK, CN of K to CN minus 1 of K. So this is a chain complex. This chain complex is called the simplicial chain complex of K. The homology groups of this group, this chain complex, are called simplicial homology groups. So this is the ultimate simplification that we sought. This CK as given is not a subchain complex of the singular chain complex of mod k. It is the quotient of a sub. So this is called a subquotient. It's a quotient of a subchain complex. Okay, nevertheless, this is our life. This brings a lot of simplification in the simplicial, in the homology of a mod k of a simplicial complex. So let us take a closer look at it, how things look like. Okay, in the very special case, namely k is just delta n itself. If you don't understand that, you can't do much. So let us understand what is C of delta n. Okay, to begin with, there is no confusion about the zero chains. There should not be, but there can be, just now as pointed out. They are merely linear combinations of vertices of delta n. Okay, therefore, C naught of k is just z power n plus 1, because there are n plus 1 vertices in delta n. Okay. Whether degenerate or non-degenerate, they are all same. There is one point map, so one point to one point, so it is all injective. So there is nothing special about that. Now let us look at the one chains. We know that S1 of delta n is z raised to n plus 1 square. Okay, because it is set of all maps from a two element set into n plus 1 element set. So that's why it is like this. But any simplex given by a non-injective map, when two of them are going to same thing, they have to be thrown away. Okay, non-injective map is a degenerate simplex, so it goes inside S0, right? Similarly, so at that level already, we can only look at the simplexes which are given by injective mapping, namely proper edges now, U, V, where U and V are distinct. That will be an edge because it's a simplicial map. Okay, from delta 1 to K. All right. Even now, if UV and VU will be two different things we are counting. So this is the next step we want to throw away. VU and UV differ by what? By transposition. And what is the sign of the transposition? Signature is minus 1. So UV plus VU will go into the subgroup, which is same thing as saying that UV and is equal to minus VU, which is how we are bringing the geometry into this. Namely, an edge traced in the other way direction is treated as a minus of that edge, minus of the simplex. Okay, so that is the next step that we have to do. Which just means that now, once you have UV, you don't have to take VU. Okay, so UV plus VU belong to the same thing. This is the one simplex. This is a story of S0. This just means that we need not count an edge in delta n. We need to count edge delta n only once. In the other direction, we don't count. What is the meaning of that? Given the number of all pairs of U, V, they will form a simplex. They will form an edge inside delta n. Therefore, it is the number of choices that we can make out of n plus 1. We have to make two of them. Two of them you have to choose. So that is n plus 1 choose 2. So there are exactly n plus 1 choose 2 non-degenerate simplexes up to order. Order means what? Only one of them we are taking. Ordered pairs. Sorry, unordered pairs we are taking. Subsets. Once you have taken UV, there is no chance to take VU. So that forms a basis. Okay. So this leaves us with n plus 1 choose 2 edges in delta n, which will form a basis for C1 of delta n. It follows that C1 of delta n is z raised to n plus 1 choose 2. The boundary operator is obviously boundary of UV is V minus U. Okay, remember that. How boundary operator comes here. You drop out U, you get V. When you drop out V, you have to put a sign here. Right? So this is one. So this much understanding is there from C1 to C0. Okay? Likewise, the same argument will give you the Q chains delta N will be generated by n plus 1 choose q plus 1 such elements, namely q plus 1 subsets of n plus 1 set. And it is generated over that freely, so this is z power n plus 1 choose q plus 1. Now boundary of this map cq to cq minus 1 is given by this formula, same boundary map. Okay, q naught q, q n minus 1. Remember, all these, when I write Q and Q, I am thinking them as now elements of CQ, which is a quotient space. So it is actually equivalence class. Okay. If I change the order here, I will have to put a minus sign. If I change the order twice, it doesn't matter. It is the same element. For example, u naught, u1, u2 is equal to minus u1, u0, u2, but it's equal to plus u1, u2, u0. So that is the meaning of this in this group. That is the way we have to think of these elements. Okay. In any case, this formula comes from directly from the formula for S itself. You have to operate, you have to take this and operate the phase operator on this side. Then this is the how it is, and put a minus on the next one and take the summation. This entire chain looks like starting with one choose n plus one, this is zero simplexes, two choose and n plus one choose two, one simplexes, and so on. This will be, there is only one n plus one, there is only one n simplex, namely you have to take the entire set. Okay, if you change it by a permutation which is odd, then it will be a negative generator. If it is even permutation, it is the same generator, one single. So this is just result. And after that, all of them are zero. There are no chains left out here. Is that clear? Because you cannot choose n plus 2 subset out of n plus 1 set. These are empty sets. So this is all zero chains, zero groups here. So this is the biggest simplification which is coming here, which was not possible in the case of S double S of K also, right? It was going on infinitely. This stops at the n plus 1 and nth stage itself. So this is Cn, this is Z, okay? Then Z power n plus 1, Z power n plus 1 choose 2 and so on, Z power n. Okay, if you put one more Z here by augmentation, this looks perfectly symmetric, just like binomial expansion. And for that beauty, at least, it is better to consider the augmented chain complexes. And doing combinatorics, that is much simpler object than this one. So you better put that one more element in the augmentation by extending it by epsilon V augmentation to Z to zero after. Okay, given a simplicial complex, okay, CnK is purely an algebraic object. There is no continuity, no topology, nothing you have to discuss. Okay, once the simplicial complex is given, which is an abstract algebraic way of defining it, combinatorial way of defining it, CnK is purely an algebraic object. Okay, obviously, the boundary maps themselves will depend on the incident relations. Which simplex is sitting where? I mean, what are the vertices of an edge? What are the vertices of a triangle? Which triangle has which of the edges are there? This is only incidences, incidence relation. Okay, so that is the only thing that matters. And that is like a combinatorial information that has the full control of topology is what we have seen already studying simplicial complex to some extent. So it comes again here. Therefore, one may expect that, you know, because just purely algebra here, it may have very little to say topology. However, the following results come as a pleasant surprise. So what is that surprise? These are the two statements here. The inclusion map from the full singular simplicial chain complex to the singular chain complex of mod k and mod l. Here they are topological. This part is purely topological. This is purely purely combinatorial. This inclusion map is a chain homotopy equivalent. Exactly same way, the quotient from this smaller thing to CKL, this is a chain homotopy equivalent. You already know that chain homotopy equivalences induce isomorphisms on the homology groups. So combining these two, what you get? It's a homology of this topological space is isomorphic to homology of this object, is isomorphic to homology of this object. So that is the big result that we get. So I'm going to state that one. For pairs of simplicial complexes, there are canonical isomorphisms of singular homology H star of S dot mod K mod L, the singular simplicial homology H star of S dot of KL, and the simplicial homology H star of CKL. So what are they? First one is inclusion induced map. Okay. If it's H star of S, we are not writing this S at all. We are taking it for granted. We are writing H star of KL. Okay, but here I have to write it because this is something different from this one. Similarly, phi star from S star of KL to C of KL, okay? So that gives you I star from phi star inverse. So you take the inverse of this one and follow by that one from CKL to H star of KL. So from here, go here and come back here. So that is a canonical isomorphism. That is the statement. We are going to postpone the proof of this isomorphism theorem here. The homology of C dot KL will be referred to as the simplicial homology of the simplicial pair. When L is empty, it is purely C dot of K. Okay, simplicial homology of K, of a simplicial complex. Okay. As such, it depends upon the actual simplicial complex. That much is obvious. But however, once we have proved the above theorem, it means that it will depend only on the topological space, underlying topological space. That means if I change the triangle, take a simplicial complex, take its underlying space, I may be able to put another simplicial complex structure on that. And then compute the homology there. No problem, the homology will be the same. So that is the thing. It does not depend upon what triangulation you take, provided you have a triangulation. Then it is the same thing. It will give you the homology of the underlying topological space. Okay, therefore this freedom is very important. This was a very, very deep result, actually, very strong result, which the singular chain complex was able to attain. The similarity I see here, you know, there are problems about Riemann integration. To solve that, you have to invent, you know, Lebesgue had to invent another integration theory, namely Lebesgue integration theory. Come out of the Riemann integration, then only you could prove the theorem about Riemann integration, namely the characterization of functions which are Riemann integrable in terms of the number of points of discontinuities of the function. It is similar to that. To prove that it is invariant of the underlying topological space, so you have to invent another homology. Just reframing the simplicial homology, there was no way. In fact, some way which was thought by Poincaré was wrong. He had summed up. There's no way to complete that into a proof. Okay, so we will stop here and continue this study next time.